Hello viewers, today we are going to discuss another topic, that is direct pulp capping. And as the name suggests, the direct pulp capping is a procedure when you have to save the vitality of the pulp even when the pulp exposure has occurred. So what is the procedure that we will discuss today? And what are the indications, contraindications, what are the agents through which you can save the vitality of the pulp even when it is exposed. So, if we look into the definition, it is a procedure in which the exposed pulp is covered with a protective dressing or base placed directly over the site of exposure in an attempt to preserve the pulpal vitality. So, if the pulp exposure has already occurred and if all the criteria like the conditions are aseptic and the exposure is not too much, it is a pinpoint exposure and it is an iatrogenic exposure, then you can go ahead with your direct pulp capping procedure. You can cover it with the help of a protective dressing, pulp capping agent, like we discussed in the entire pulp capping. You can cover it with the calcium hydroxide and then you can go ahead with your permanent restoration, and of course you have to check the vitality of the pulp. So that's how you're going to preserve the pulpal vitality. As we have discussed again and again, that we should make every effort to preserve the pulpal vitality. So this is also one of the procedures that will be preserving the pulpal vitality. Now, what are the indications? First, the indication is iatrogenic pulpal exposure of pulp in an asymptomatic vital tooth with sound dentine at the periphery. So iatrogenic means that is done by the clinician. Any pulpal exposure that has happened by mistake by the clinician only. So suppose you are making a cavity and during the preparation of the cavity only a pinpoint exposure has occurred. So in that case you can go ahead with the direct pulp capping procedure, because you are working under the rubber dam and the conditions are aseptic, bacteria and all everything you removed, but while removing the caries this pulpal exposure has happened. So in that case you can go ahead with the direct pulp capping procedure. And asymptomatic vital tooth means that the tooth should not have any symptoms like pain and swelling like that. Okay, so in those cases you can go ahead with your direct pulp capping procedure, and it should have sound dentine at the periphery. It should not be a large caries exposure, and you know, the dentine is undermined, so that should not be there. Dentine should be sound at the periphery so that restoration can be done later on. What are the contraindications? Suppose if the patient comes to you with a caries lesion, okay, then you cannot go ahead with your direct pulp capping procedure. Suppose the patient has come to you with a pain, chief complaint of pain, and when you look into the patient there's a large caries lesion that has exposed the pulp, and in those cases you cannot go ahead with your direct pulp capping procedure because the bacteria has already gone inside the pulp. And when the bacteria is already there, then as a sequelae of dental caries, the pulpal inflammation, necrosis, everything will happen. So even if you do the direct pulp capping procedure, that won't be successful and it might increase the pain of the patient also. So in those cases you will not do direct pulp capping procedure. Mainly it is iatrogenic only. In the iatrogenic cases you have to do the direct pulp capping procedure. And caries exposure of the primary tooth, you cannot do over there also. Then thickening of the periodontal space of periapical lesion, if it is present, then also you cannot do. Obviously, because it is a sequelae of the dental caries only. Because of endodontic origin, if periapical lesion has occurred, that means it is because of the dental caries. So dental caries was there first in the enamel, then it got into the dentine, then from dentine into the pulp, and then from pulp into the periapical tissue. So because of that, if the periapical lesion is present, then obviously the pulp has become necrosed. So in that case, there is no point in, you cannot, what is the point of doing direct pulp capping when the pulp is necrosed? no reparative dent information will be there. So if periapical lesion is there and the widening of the PDL space, which indicates inflammation, if it is there, then you cannot go ahead with your direct pulp capping procedure. Then what are the factors affecting the prognosis of dental direct pulp capping procedure? The caries pulpal exposure will lead to inflammation and subsequent necrosis. So if there is a caries pulpal exposure, then there will be inflammation and then necrosis. So caries pulpal exposure may you do not do the direct pulp capping procedure. If it is a mechanical exposure, as I have told you before also, like iatrogenic exposure, then it will have a better prognosis. Then coming to the size of lesion, if it is a larger exposure, then the healing will be very low. And if it is a pinpoint exposure, small exposure, then it will have a better prognosis. Then the time gap. The longer the time gap between the exposure and you doing the direct pulp capping procedure, the prognosis will become less. So time gap should be as low as possible. Why? If there is a long time gap between the exposure and the procedure, then there will be more bacterial and micro leakage and there will be more contamination. That's why the time gap, as soon as the exposure is occurred, you should go ahead with your direct pulp capping procedure. The physical phenomena associated with mechanical pulpal exposures. As we all know that the dentin acts as an insulator inside the tooth. So when we are working in the deep caries lesion, the dentin is either very less or it is not present in case of the exposures. So whatever heat that is produced by the burr, that is transferred to the pulp directly and it will lead to the injury of the pulp. The more heat that is going inside the pulp, it will lead to the less favorable prognosis. So we have to use a proper coolant to reduce the heat. Then pressure, greater the pressure, less favorable will be the prognosis. Hemorrhage, extravasated blood by itself cause some injury to the underlying pulp by means of increased pressure. How this increased pressure has occurred? Because of the bleeding, the inside the pulp. The pulp is encased inside the dentin. Okay, so the pulp cannot expand. And because of this, whatever bleeding is present inside the pulp, it will lead to increased pressure inside the pulp. Since the pulp cannot expand, so it will lead to the increased pressure inside the pulp. And that pressure will then in turn lead to the injury, even more injury into the pulp. So the hemorrhage can also cause injury to the pulp. In the intrusion of dentinal chips, when you are making the cavity, there will be some intrusion of the dentinal chips also. Some microorganism also, they can get inside the pulp. They will also reduce the prognosis. Now coming to the techniques of the direct pulp capping procedure. First of all, again same thing like how we discussed in the indirect pulp capping. You have to give LA, you have to do isolation, then you have to remove the undermined enamel with carbide burr and the spoon excavator. Then in case of the mild bleeding, hemostasis is achieved with the help of the sodium hypochlorite that is placed on the exposure site for 1 to 10 minutes. Now if bleeding does not stop, then it means that it is irreversible pulpitis and you have to go for the root canal procedure and DPC can. Then apply calcium hydroxide or MTA over the exposed pulp. And in calcium hydroxide technique, glass cyanoma cement should be given as a temporary restoration. And if you are doing it in single step, then you can go ahead with the composite restoration in that appointment itself. And then you have to recall the patient and check for the vitality, check for the periapical lesion, check the history of the patient, take the history of the patient. Okay, if everything is normal, then you can go ahead with your final restoration. So in MTA DPC, you have to mix MTA and place over the exposure site. And the thickness of the MTA that you are placing over the exposure site should be at least 1.5 mm. That should be the minimum thickness of MTA that is placed over the site of the exposure, pulpal exposure. Okay, then over that MTA you have to place moist cotton. Why do you have to place moist cotton? Because the MTA requires moist environment for setting. Why? Because MTA is a hydrophilic material. So MTA needs moisture for setting. For that we are placing moist cotton over MTA. Then what do we do? Then we have to place a non-bonded composite material and we have to seal the tooth. Okay, so we have to place a non-bonded composite material over the MTA and we have to recall the patient. Then we have to recall the patient after 5 to 10 days and complete the treatment. We have to remove the composite material that we placed earlier, the non-bonded composite material. We have to remove the moist cotton also. Then we have to do the selective etching and we can go ahead with a permanent restoration with composite that we can do in next appointment. Okay. And if we are doing a single sitting direct pulp capping with MTA, then we have to place GIC over MTA and then we can do selective etching and go ahead with our composite restoration in the first appointment itself. Again, I want to remind you people that if you are doing a two sitting direct pulp capping procedure, then in the second sitting you have to again check the pulpal vitality, you have to take the radiograph, you have to take proper history of the patient. After the evaluation of everything, the periapical tissues, everything, then only you should go ahead with your final restoration or permanent restoration. Okay. In single sitting also, if you are doing DPC in single sitting, then also you should keep the follow-up of the patient. You have to recall the patient from time to time and you have to check for the vitality of the tooth and you have to check the status of the pulp. Okay. What are the requirements of the ideal pulp capping agent? First of all, it should maintain the vitality of the pulp. Then it should stimulate the reparative dentin formation. That is our aim. Obviously, that has to be stimulated by the agent. Then bactericidal and bacteriostatic effect it should have. Then it should adhere well to the dentin and restorative material. And it should resist the forces under the restoration. It should be sterile and it should be radio opaque. Okay, so these are the ideal qualities, the requirements of the pulp. Then how does the healing occur with calcium hydroxide? So there are certain zones. If you place calcium hydroxide over the exposed pulp, there are certain zones that are formed inside the pulp. So what are those zones? First of all, there is a zone of obliteration. In the pulp tissue next to calcium hydroxide, it is deranged due to high concentration of hydroxyl ions. It consists of dentinal debris, hemorrhage, blood clot and calcium hydroxide. Okay, so because calcium hydroxide will dissociate into calcium and true hydroxyl ion. So because of that, it has a very alkaline effect. So because of that alkaline effect, the highly alkaline and slightly caustic effect of calcium hydroxide, there will be some, you know, dentinal debris, there's some necrosis that will be taking place beneath the calcium hydroxide. Okay, so this zone of obliteration will consist of dentinal debris, hemorrhage, blood clot and calcium hydroxide that you placed. Then zone of coagulation necrosis. Coagulation necrosis may chemical effect reaches the subjacent zone, that is beneath the zone of obliteration, more periapical tissue and results in zone of coagulation necrosis. As I told you, there will be some necrosis beneath the calcium hydroxide. So beneath the zone of obliteration, a zone of coagulation necrosis will be taking place because of the chemical effect of the calcium hydroxide that will reach the zone beneath the obliteration zone. Then a line of demarcation, that is between the coagulation necrosis and the vital pulp. So this line of demarcation will be there between the coagulation necrosis zone and the vital pulp, and it will lead it will have protein lobules. So proteins are forming over here. So this is the line of demarcation. So this is a diagram I have made this diagram. It is showing the restoration. Beneath the restoration, there is a calcium hydroxide, and base, that is the final restoration. Beneath the restoration, there is a layer of calcium hydroxide and base over the calcium hydroxide. And in the pulp tissue, we can see that there is a localized tissue destruction, and beneath that localized tissue destruction, reparative dentin formation is. So what does the calcium hydroxide do? First of all, calcium hydroxide creates a superficial necrosis in the pulp, as we saw in the diagram and we saw in the zones also. So there will be a superficial necrosis in the pulp first of all. This necrosis will cause irritation and stimulation in the pulp. Because of this necrosis, the pulp will try to defend itself, and therefore there will be some irritation. Because of that irritation, pulp will try to defend itself, and therefore the stimulation will happen. So pulp how will the pulp defend itself? Pulp defends itself by creation of reparative dentine bridge. Okay, so that is a process of defense only from the pulp side. So pulp defends itself by the creation of reparative dentine bridge by cellular differentiation, extracellular matrix secretion, and subsequent mineralization. That is mineralization of reparative dentine by the formation of the reparative dentine. Then calcium hydroxide can solubilize BMP and tissue growth factor beta 1 proteins from dentine. Therefore, it will lead to the pulp repair. Okay, so this is also the mechanism of action of calcium hydroxide. So in dentine, there are some tissue growth factors, there are BMPs, okay, and proteins. So the calcium hydroxide, which is placed beneath the placed over the pulp, it will solubilize those growth factors, and therefore it will lead to the repair of the pulp. Thank you for your patient listening, and if you like the lecture, then please like and subscribe the channel. Thank you once again.